world order, when it's fully realized and it's fully come to full fruition, those who have accepted Lucifer, as Satan, as their leader, as their chief, as their head, as their God, are going to be fully possessed by the spirit of Antichrist. This is why the Bible-believing, God-fearing Christians are not going to be tolerated. See, the Bible gives a clear distinction that when the Antichrist goes and makes war with this woman, which is Israel, and God protects her, he gets so frustrated that he goes and makes war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And that is the church. It is the true church. These are the true worshipers that worship the Father and Spirit and the truth. And when the Messiah comes, he is going to come and Israel is going to finally realize. See, because God is going to bring Israel through the fire. The Bible prophesied that he was going to bring a third of them through the fire. So two-thirds of the Jews are going to be totally white. And for those that are so based in carnality, that talk about the Jews, it's not just Jews that have skin that appear to be light. They have Jews that are Phylacian Jews, Ethiopian Jews, Beta Israel. And they returned to Israel from 1979 to 1991 under Operation Moses and Operation Solomon. And they fight side by side with all the Israels. And they don't distinguish between the Jews.
The Jews of Ethiopia call themselves Beta Israel, which means the House of Israel. Beta Israel was isolated for thousands of years from the rest of the Jewish world. In May 1991, the State of Israel launched Operation Solomon to rescue the 15,000 remaining Ethiopian Jews in Ethiopia during an incredible 6-hour period. There was a time when the Jews of Ethiopia were a mighty tribe that ruled the land. Living in their thatched huts, they ruled the mountain highlands around Lake Tana. They were a people who studied the Torah, who were strictly observant, and remembered when Jerusalem was mighty. A total of 36 jumbo jets and transport planes, with all the seats removed to accommodate the maximum number of passengers, brought the last of the Beta Israel to their new home in Israel. Of the Jewish state as the beacon of light for distressed Jews the world over was never more clearly shown than in this amazing exercise of humanity.
But let me tell you what's so significant about Israel. See, God has no respect of person. He has no respect of flesh. But let me tell you, it's two immutable things about God. God does not change and he cannot lie. And he promised Abraham that he was going to preserve his seed forever. This is what God said. And God, I'm going to tell you, his name means everything. By his name, he promised Abraham that he was going to preserve his seed forever. And he was going to bring them back into the land. I'm looking for these two candlesticks, these two prophets, to show up. They should be approaching pretty soon their mission in Israel, where they're going to prophesy for 1,260 days or 42 months in sackcloth and ashes. And these two prophets, these candlesticks standing before the God of the earth, is going to be Moses and Elijah. And the Bible says they're going to turn the hearts of the children back to the fathers, and the hearts of the fathers back to the children, lest he come and smite the earth with a curse. And what does that mean? Do you have a clear perspective what that means? It means that the Jews have lost their way, but they're going to come to a true wholehearted perspective of their purpose of seeking God and spirit and the truth. And then when God comes, he's going to finally reveal who he is. And see, this is why I love the Word of God so much. See, everything that has been written before our time, it was written before, was written for our admonition upon whom the end of the world may come. See, God already wrote the blueprint. He wanted us to know, you true saints, the true worshipers, those that worship God in spirit and truth. It's already been written. You must trust in the Lord, and you must be willing to die. Lay down your life for Christ. To live is Christ. To die is gain. To be absent in this physical body means to be present with the Lord. But this is so important. I want you to turn to Zechariah chapter 12, verse 1. And I'm gonna let you know that Israel is going to come to pass, that they're going to realize that this peace plan that they made, because the Bible says, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction should come upon them as travail, coming upon the one with child, and they should not escape. Well, when Antichrist comes, he's going to be the one to establish the covenant, this peace covenant, which is going to last just for 3.5 years. And then he's going to bring his whole army to try to finally destroy Israel. And once he can't do that, he's going to really go all out and try to kill the rest of the Christians. But God is going to preserve some saints. Not all going to die. Not all should sleep. But some of us are going to be caught up. You know what I mean? Those that are alive and remain are going to be caught up together to meet them in the cloud of the air. So, you know, and there should we be. There shall we be with the Lord forever. Well, God is coming here to descend, to establish his kingdom. The Bible says that God is coming with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed. God said he's coming in flaming fire, taking vision on those who know not God and who obey not the gospel. Chapter 12, verse 1, it says, the burden of the word of the Lord said, the burden of the word of the Lord for Israel said, the Lord will stretch forth the heavens and lay at the foundation of the earth and form the spirit of man within him. He says, behold, I will make Jerusalem. This is what God saying. He said, I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. And all that burden themselves with it should be cut into pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. And what does all the people of the earth represent? The United Nations. No other nation upon the face of the earth has had as many against it, except for Israel. This small little place, and when it was established in 1948, you know, the United Nations labeled Jerusalem as a corporate separatum.
No matter how you feel about the United Nations, it's the one place on planet Earth where nations get together and attempt to speak with one voice. That's why their resolutions can make a big difference. So when people all around the world see that approximately 40% of the UN Human Rights Council resolutions were against just one country, most of us would assume that country must be a really bad place. Perhaps ruled by, oh, say, a genocidal dictator who kills his own people, or maybe a tyrant continually threatening to annihilate another country. But actually, the country that has been condemned more times than every repressive country on Earth combined is a democracy. The only viable democracy in the Middle East, Israel. And with these repeated resolutions against Israel, it's easy to see why so many in the international community perceive Israel as a major cause of world problems. But are all these resolutions really justified? Because whether or not you agree with how Israel is handling its many challenges, when you do a basic comparison, like the number of deaths Israel is responsible for with the number of condemnations they've received, and then make that same comparison with other countries, it paints a surprising picture of a possible double standard.
They got the whole world unified as a united body, but they consider Jerusalem as its own entity, a corpus separatum. And they're gonna establish Jerusalem as the international headquarters for the Antichrist. Satan wants that. Jaru means dwelling place, and Salam means peace. So when you hear the words Jaru, Salam, that means dwelling place of peace. Well, the King of Peace, which is the King of Righteousness, is coming to establish his throne. His feet is gonna touch down on the temple turns. He's coming to Jerusalem. And this is what the whole dispute is upon right now, because after the Six-Day War, which was 1967, June 5th to June 11th, you had 6 days. The 7 days, June 12th, they had the East Jerusalem, they had West Jerusalem, they had Jordan, they had all that. They didn't want to rule over any Arabs. They just wanted their land, which was promised to them, that was prophetically promised to them. And they got it back. Okay, now the whole dispute is going on right now with the situation with these Palestinians, which are none but really Philistines. They want Israel to pull back to the pre-1967 borders. But this is not going to happen, see? The Bible says that the land is not to be parted nor divided. As a matter of fact, the West Bank, all that belongs to Israel. If you get a chance, go on and do a Google search and look up the land that was promised to Abraham. Okay, now the land that was promised to Abraham went from Abraham to Isaac, not Ishmael, which is the father of Arab nations. It went from Abraham to Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob. Jacob didn't believe, he wrestled with God, and God changed Jacob's name into Israel. Israel had 12 sons, which became the 12 patriarchs, or the 12 tribes of Israel. And out of that, you had Israel. Now, the reason why they've gone through so many changes is because God is chastising. And God finally did away with Judaism, and he's never going to use Judaism again. No man can ever come to God except through Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus, the Messiah, God Almighty, came to do, to establish the new covenant. But when he does return, Israel is going to turn back to him. So God has established a church to provoke Israel to jealousy, that they may turn back. But God wants us to have love for the Jewish nation. Just as we accepted Jesus and we're under God's protection and his grace, which means unmerited favor, we must establish the same grace to Israel. Because it's not of works, it's not of righteousness, and everything that Israel was trying to attain by the works of the law, it has been nothing but a thorn in their side. So Jesus came to bring true freedom.